4:00, I will call to order this City Council Committee on City Services meeting. And note that the chair, Maureen Carney, Ward 1, and present we also have, I'll let folks introduce themselves.
Dennis Bidwell, Ward 2, City Councilor.
Jim Nash, Ward 3, City Councilor.
City Councilor Mary Ann LaBarge, Vice Chair.
And we have with us as well Pam Powers, our City Clerk, who at the last moment has stepped in to help as our assistant, administrative assistant, was sick and unable to be here today. So we're very grateful for her helping us today. And as is typical with our City Council meetings and subcommittee meetings, we open our session with a period of public comment. And as is typical, there's a 3-minute limit to comments that people would like to offer. And then we'll go on from there. We're not allowed at that, during that point, to respond to comments made directly to us. But they may be addressed further on during the meeting if a councilor chooses to bring that up. So I think without further ado, I'll step right into the session on public comment. And the first name I have on the list is for Patricia Shaughnessy.
Good afternoon, thank you for the opportunity. We're losing two wonderful employees at the Senior Center, Heather Kaylee and Victoria Hunt. And we also are losing 5 extraordinary board members all around this particular appointment for a new director. It's unfortunate that the Council on Aging Board Chair did not speak to board members and or other seniors, because I don't think that a lot of this would be happening now, whether it's rumor or back talk or resignations. I just think it's very unfortunate this happened in our city, because it's a great senior center. A lot of terrific seniors use that building, and some were not seniors. It's just a great building with a great staff, which a number of staff and City Council on Aging board members are not gone. So that's a tremendous loss for our community. Thank you.
Thank you. The next name on the list is Susan McGuire.
Good afternoon. Many people are saying that the Beast Road will reopen as soon as the new director comes on board. Although the city's documented job description calls for a special requirement of ServSafe certification, the person presently appointed does not have that certification. Therefore, the Bistro will not be reopening soon. Heather has that full certification along with CPR and is allergen certified. Under Heather's leadership, I was the volunteer that managed the cooks act from the jail for the Bistro. I was asked to do this because of my experience in working with probationers and offenders. Heather, the other volunteers, and the men from the jail formed a great team, and the Bistro was running well and operating in the black. Today, I ask you to not refer to the council the present candidate for appointment as director of the Senior Center, as she does not currently have the special requirements of ServSafe as required by the job description. Thank you.
Harry Petrucci.
Thank you for the opportunity to speak before your subcommittee. I would just like to say to you, as city councilors, you do have an obligation to your constituents, and they include the senior community. I think you're doing an injustice to those people if you perpetrate the appointment that the mayor suggests. If you are just going to act as a rubber stamp to whatever the mayor wants, you should start thinking about your positions as city councilors. If the mayor is doing an injustice to the population of North Hampton, you should be writing it, and you have that opportunity to do so. And I would hope you would do so. Otherwise, why bother having a city council that you get a stipend for if all you're going to do is rubber stamp whatever the mayor wants? I would hope that you'd stand up and do what's right for your constituents and the people of North Hampton. Thank you.
Next is Marlene Morocco.
Good afternoon. I'd like to start by saying I feel really bad for all of us. I feel bad for the seniors in North Hampton, the volunteers, the staff of the Senior Center. I feel bad for the members of the Senior Center and the North Hampton community. I feel bad for the mayor. I'd like to believe that he made a decision based on what he thought was best for North Hampton seniors. But the situation isn't about the mayor. It's not about the chosen candidate. It's not about the articles, the letters to the editor, the phone calls, the news coverage. It's not even about all of us here today. It's about your opportunity as the City Services Board to demonstrate that you are listening. It's about the opportunity to change your minds based on your constituents' voices. It's about showing the North Hampton community that they do matter, to show your willingness to act on the many feelings, opinions, and voices that you've heard. Today, your vote to not refer to the council the new candidate for appointment as director of the Senior Center will speak volumes. It'll prove to North Hampton that you do listen and that you are willing to correct an oversight that has occurred that needs to be fixed. I implore you to listen to the voices of the seniors and vote down this appointment. Let's take the time to re-examine what's best for the community from those who know it best, the voices of the seniors, the staff, the volunteers, and the members of the North Hampton Senior Center. Thanks for your consideration.
Thank you. Next we have Erin Walker.
Oh.
Hi, thank you for listening to us today. You are our representatives. You work for the city, for the residents of North Hampton. You don't work for the mayor. He's making a wrong choice. The seniors of this city want Heather Calhoun, who's qualified, has added programs, who knows us, and can take this position with her feet running. The new person that the mayor has nominated is going to take at least 6 months to a year to learn this position. And in the meantime, you're going to have turmoil with the citizens who are senior citizens in this city. We're one of the largest blocks of voters, and we do go to vote every time there's an election. You need to listen to what we're telling you. You need to overturn and not nominate and approve the mayor's choice for this position. Thank you.
Thank you. Next we have Jane Bickford.
Hello, I'm not much of a public speaker, but I'm here in support of Heather as a member of the Senior Center, and I've been a volunteer in the Bistro program since it started, and it has been very positive for staff, seniors, and all the volunteers. And I just feel that she should be given a chance for the job that she has performed in the past, has the qualifications for, and that she is so well liked by volunteers, staff, and us, all the seniors, that she should have been given a chance for advancement in her job. Thank you.
Thank you. Bill Lent, please.
Hi. I'm basically here on behalf of the Gay Men Senior Group. And I think I can speak for all of us that we ditto everything that has been said previously. I'm deeply disturbed, as many of us are. I'm new to the community. I moved here 2.5 years ago. And when I asked around, who to vote for, everyone suggested our mayor. Now they're feeling quite differently. And I'm disturbed by rumors that the mayor has a feud with Heather's father, and it's looked upon as that being the reason for Heather not getting the position. I'm also disturbed by other rumors that they're looking to make the senior center into a community center, which I don't know where the room would be for the seniors. Perfectly lovely building available from Smith College next to the church on Main Street near State. Just saying. Thank you.
Thank you. Well, that's all that I have on my list, but is there anyone else who would like to? Mr. Corbett?
Hey. Back when I used to work.
Oh, thank you.
State your name for the record, please.
Oh, David Corbett. Back when I used to work quite a few years ago, there were three criteria for a job to promote: past performance, ability to do the job, and seniority. If you had all three, there's no way anybody else should have gotten a job, and they never did in the environment. And one other thing, the Mayor Higgins got federal money for a senior center, not for a recreation department or not for childcare or anything else. It was for seniors, so keep it that way. Thank you.
Thank you. Yes, please. If you could just state your name, and I have the addresses of folks here, but just state your name and address.
Sure. Hello, I'm Karen Fascia. I live on 11 Diamond Court in Florence. In regards to what was just said about seniority and experience, my question is that the mayor was looking for somebody with 5 years experience in the position to carry on as the administrator. And so, playing devil's advocate, I have been trying to look at this whole thing with an open mind in regards to Heather Kaling, knowing that she's only been in the assistant administrator's position for 2 years. However, she has been employed for 5 years, and her hours exceed a normal 40-hour a week job. So if you put 5 years experience with 40 plus years, that is considerable amount of experience. Plus, she has it in her heart to work with the people that she's worked with. It's my understanding that the new candidate, although has had 7 years experience in Williamsburg, that she worked part-time of a 20-hour week. So I want you to do the math and consider Heather with the amount of time that she had put in and what her experience really is, because I think that she has been shortchanged. With all due respect, no hard feelings are coming from me. It's just I would like to see the correct person come in and have Heather be given the respect and the recognition of the time she has put in over the last 5 years. Thank you.
Thank you. Is there anyone else who would like to speak? Okay, if not, then I'm going to ask committee members if they would actually offer an move up the order, typical order of business, and where we had under discussion of the appointment process, item number 5, I thought that it might be relevant to have that discussion first and then move on to the next items on the agenda. Is that, would someone like to?
Yes, I'll make the motion that we take
that number 5 out of
take
order?
That number 5 out of order.
A second.
Oh, okay. All those in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Thank you. So if you have an agenda before you, you'll just see that we had on our agenda a discussion of the appointment process. And one of our supporting documents is the Charter Section 2-10, which I will, in fact, read now for members of present and then open it to the floor for discussion. So Section 210 of our city charter says city council confirmation of certain appointments. The mayor shall refer to the city council and simultaneously file with the city clerk the name of each person the mayor desires to appoint as a department head or as a member of a multi-member body, but not including any position which is subject to the civil service law. The city council shall refer each name submitted to a standing committee of the council, which shall review each candidate for appointment and shall make a recommendation to the full city council not less than 7 nor more than 45 days after the referral. The committee may require any person whose name has been referred to appear before the committee or before the city council to give any information relevant to the appointment that the committee or the city council may require. Appointments made by the mayor shall become effective on the 45th day after the date on which the notice of proposed appointment was filed with the city clerk, unless approved or rejected by the city council within the 45 days. And that's basically the charter rules that we need to apply. I'll also add that the City Services Committee is the standing committee that's referred to in that charter section. It hasn't always been. At one point we had a separate committee for appointments. At one point appointments were taken up by the Rules and Ordinances Committee, which has now become a separate Legislative Matters Committee. But for the last 4 years, I think it has been the practice of the, it has been the, in the purview of the City Services Committee to review appointments that are referred to us and then send back a recommendation. On that recommendation, what we have are three choices. We can send back to the full city council a positive recommendation, a negative recommendation, or a neutral recommendation. And with that, I'll open it up, please, for discussion among members. Any comments from?
Is this set up so that we can ask questions of the candidate, or are we just speaking among
ourselves?
Yes,
we'll do that when we move to the, right now we're dealing with just the discussion.
Oh, just the discussion, okay, gotcha. No, I think it's very, very clear. We can, the council as a whole can approve or reject. And we as a committee can recommend approval, recommend rejection, or recommend neutral, as you said. So I think it's quite clear what our options are.
Does anybody else have anything to add around that? Just because we had that as a, just kind of a way of clarification what this committee's role is, excuse me, and what the city council's role is according to the charter. Well, yes, Councilor.
Yes, I was just wondering if I could make a motion to have the mayor come forward in regards to speak about the process. I think he needs to do that, of a process of how you make a selection.
Ms. Councilor, I believe I was going to be given an opportunity to introduce the nominee, and I was going to do it at that time, but if you'd like me to do it now, I'm happy to do that.
That would be fine.
Okay.
So I'll ask then, if folks don't mind, we'll move right forward with item number 4. We'll come back to approval of minutes afterwards, if that's okay. And then we'll let the mayor.
Yeah.
So the item number 4 is appointment of Marie Westberg as Director of Senior Services. Mm-hmm. That was referred to us on April 5th. And I'll turn it over to the mayor.
Thank you.
Yes. You mean to recognize?
No, to item number 4.
Yes, we need to make that motion.
Okay. She's moved to item number 4. Is there a second?
Second.
All those in favor?
Aye.
Thank you.
Good afternoon, members of the committee. Thank you so much for holding this hearing. So in response to Councilor Barge's question about the process, you read section 2. There's a corresponding article in the charter about, you know, article 3 about the mayor, you know, putting forward appointments and making these appointments. I utilized a process that I've used for all of my other department head hires, including most recently when I appointed Linda Desmond as the director of the Senior Center. The position was advertised you know, in local newspapers, it was advertised online, it was sent out to the Mass Council of Aging, has a extensive email list, a network that we frequently send jobs related to this out, so we advertise the position. And again, as has been my practice, this is my appointment, but I put together a screening committee in order to help me, advise me in terms of screening the initial round of applicants. We had 30 applicants, I believe, for this position. The composition of the screening committee, again, is sort of the same, modeled after the same composition I've used in all of my other nominations. In this case, obviously the screening committee is staffed and led by someone from our HR department, our human resources department, sort of convenes and staffs the committee. Then I had a, in this case, I had two members of the Council on Aging Board. I asked the chair, Mr. Montague, to serve as a representative of that body. And I also asked Catherine Service, Kathy Service, to serve as a representative, to be on that screening committee. Finally, I wanted to have some subject matter expertise, and so I asked a sitting senior center director from another community to serve on the screening committee, obviously somebody who was not applying for the position. And in this case, I asked the director of the South Hadley Senior Services or Council on Aging to serve on this screening committee. And again, this is similar process. When I hired our IT director, I asked the IT director of Westfield to serve on the screening committee. When I hired other positions, I typically like to have somebody who's actually served in the position. Not the incumbent, that's also a practice. I have never had an incumbent, an outgoing director serve on that committee, just for a number of reasons. I just don't think it's a good practice to have somebody who's retiring, leaving, be part of that process. So I did want to have somebody who is in a position in a neighboring community. I then asked a city councilor. As councilors know, it's also been my practice to include city councilors in some way in the process because of this important, you know, connection that we have in terms of the charter, of the council ultimately having to vote on the nomination. So I've always felt it was important to have a city councilor be part of that process so that in some ways they can attest to their colleagues about how the process was conducted, which I believe was conducted very professionally and obviously in accordance with all Massachusetts employment laws. Previous search process, Councilor LaBarge served in that capacity on the screening committee. Those folks then, you know, had the task of going through the various applications that came in to screen them, and their role was to ultimately send me people that they viewed were, you know, the most qualified candidates, which they did, and I then thanked them for their service, thanked them for the work on this, and it was, you know, several days of work in terms of meeting and going through applications, determining who they wanted to get additional information from and interview if necessary, and then, you know, they forwarded their recommendations. I then in turn conducted my own process of the folks who had been sent to me, and selected the applicant that I have put before the city council. And so that's really the process, Council. Yep.
Thank you.
And with that, speaking
Well, I'll of, ask if there's any other questions regarding that.
Sure.
From members of the committee?
I just want to click. So is it my understanding there was four candidates that were sent forward from the screening committee that were sent to you for consideration?
That is correct. I can confirm that. I obviously cannot speak about any other you know, details about who those people are or any of their information. The only person that I obviously will and can discuss is the person who I put forward as my appointee. But I'm, you know, not at liberty to talk about any of the other 29 applicants.
Counselor?
Yes.
Now, Mayor, if, say I was an employee of the city, and I would have the rights no matter what, because of belonging to a union, you can go ahead and go through a process. They cannot be not denied, correct? Say they fill out an application, an employee for a posted position, mandatory, you would have to go ahead and accept that posting of that employee of the city and let them go through the process, right? That does not mean that they're going to get the position, correct?
For some of our union contracts, that there is provisions about, and actually there's separate posting provisions. You know, when we post a job, we not only post it externally, we also post it internally, as a requirement of our contracts. And obviously we, you know, we have to ensure that people that are members of that collective bargaining unit are given a full and fair opportunity to participate in the process, which again, as you said, that does not mean that anyone who is a member of a union gets the position. It just means that they have to be given a chance to be part of that process.
So once the first process of the screening committee and made a recommendation of 4 applicants, it was sent to your office, correct? Who else was involved with you in the interviewing process?
So in terms of what I did is I obviously reviewed the applications that were sent to me, you know, the package and the resumes and other materials, cover letters, those kinds of things. And I then worked with the HR department to schedule one-on-one interviews with each of those individuals. And as part of that, I asked my chief of staff to sit in on those interviews with me. And we basically modeled similar to any interview process. I know you've been participated in many of these. Prior to that, we came up with a set of questions that I wanted to kind of explore. And we basically used those same questions for all of the candidates, so all of the people that I met with. And this was similar to the screening process, and it's similar to most of the job hirings, you know, that the city conducts, whether it's, you know, police or fire. Try to ask a uniform set of questions in order to be able to properly evaluate, you know, candidates and compare their responses, et cetera. In addition to that, I did also ask for, requested a writing sample from folks, which again, this is a department head level position, and that's sometimes helpful to, it's a way to glean additional information, not just about their writing, but to try to get some additional information. So I then had interviews with those folks, one-on-one interviews, and then after that, did, you know, had to really think about who I felt was the best person at this particular time to serve as our next senior services director. At that point, once I had made that decision, I then spoke with that particular candidate and got permission from them to be able to do a more deeper background check prior to making any kind of a public, you know, reference check, et cetera, which again, we typically would not do until we feel that somebody is the final person. I did significant due diligence in that regard, speaking to current and former employers, speaking to other folks who had dealings with the individual, and then, you know, finalized the appointment and made the offer, and then submitted it to the city council and to the city clerk in accordance with the charter.
Was there any form of communication there? I know we had 2 board members, that were on the screening committee, and then you have a chair from that board that was on that screening committee. Was there any previous communication of how that whole entire board felt? Because there's such a controversy going
yeah.
on about communication.
And I know this has been a question we've gotten, recently about what the role of the Council on Aging Board is.
Yeah, there's a mix-up.
And
somewhere.
Obviously, under our administrative code for the city, the Council on Aging Board is not advisory to the mayor. It's not advisory to the city council. It's advisory to the senior center and the director of the senior center. It's not a board that has any budgetary, approval. It does not have any approval over hirings, personnel. That is all the realm of the director. And in the case of the director position itself, the mayor. But obviously, I understand that they play a big role in terms of being volunteers, being helping to be a sounding board for the director. That's why I wanted to make sure that I had two members of the board. I did not get involved beyond that in terms of appointing them and having them serve on the committee. I can't really speak to what communications they may have had with their fellow board members. Obviously, it's challenging because they understood that they are not allowed to discuss the candidates because they're part of a formal employment process. And so they had a very limited role, and they had to respect the confidentiality of all of the employees. And I think we've provided this information. I mean, there's a reason for that. There's obviously privacy laws. Even as a municipality, those same employment and privacy laws apply. This information is exempt from the public records law. It's not, no one can request, I want a copy of, John Smith's job application, or I want you to tell me, did he apply? Obviously, it's a privacy issue. It's also, if a city wants to be able to hire qualified people, it would be very difficult to do that if they could not have some level of confidentiality, particularly if they're already working for another employer, and maybe they don't want their employer to know that they're applying for a job, which is what often happens. So the Council on Aging folks would have been, obviously they help provide some context to the senior center and to the work of the board, et cetera. But in terms of their then being able to, go out and discuss everything that happened at the preliminary, that wouldn't have been something that they could do. And that's no different than any other screening committee for any other city department, whether it's the Parks and Rec or whether it's police or whatever. That information really can't be discussed. So it's unfortunate if they're being put in a position that they're somehow being told that they should have done this, but they really can't. And so that's sort of the way the process was structured was I had them on there to provide some insight in terms of the screening process, but it was not beyond that in terms of selecting the final person. That is obviously the role that's delegated to me. I take it very seriously. I spent a lot of time, and I again believe that I put forward the best candidate for the position.
So what I'm actually hearing from you, Mayor, is that the advisory board of the senior center, that they are not the advisory board to you, correct?
That is correct.
Who do they go to?
So the Council on Aging Board, again, is advisory to the senior center, to basically to the director. They work with, the director is the person who obviously staffs the board and attends their meetings. And again, this is not something unique to Northampton. This is the same in every community, and the Council on Aging are fairly well spelled out.
Unlike a board, for example, you know, in our charter or in the administrative code, we have, you know, advisory boards. We have you know, quasi judicial boards like the license commission, you know, that actually have independent authority, like the board of health, etc. They're not advisory. They're basically making decisions. The planning board, in some ways, is kind of half and half. They do advisory and they also do that sort of quasi judicial role. You know, there are higher sort of level policy level bodies like the Energy and Sustainability Commission and the Transportation Parking Commission, which do advise the mayor, and they're set up to advise the mayor. But that's a different role in terms of, you know, reviewing legislation and sponsoring legislation. This is strictly limited to, it's actually very analogous to the Parks and Rec Commission. The Parks and Rec Commission is set up to be advisory to the Parks and Rec Director and to work with them in terms of, you know, policies and programs and activities, et cetera, within that realm. So that's really that's the way the structure is. It's not new. It's nothing that has changed.
Then why, Mayor, would the board itself come to City Council in open public session and voice their concerns of you as a mayor not hearing their voices? I need an explanation.
Well, I can't speak to the folks who came and spoke, and I certainly appreciate and, you know, value their opinion on this. But what I can say is that the Council on Aging Board, you know, is a multi-member body of the city. It's a public body under Massachusetts law, and it actually has to. It can only speak as a group, and it can only speak or take an action in the context of a public meeting, like a duly called public meeting. And so, obviously, individual board members can come and speak as citizens, and they can say that there are individual board members. But until and unless a board were to, you know, have a posted meeting and have an agenda item that they were going to take a vote on something, and then they took a vote on something, then you could say the Council on Aging Board has said this or recommended this. Again, I'm not to take away from the folks who are here and the folks who have spoken out, and, you know, the people. I obviously have great respect for all the members of the Council on Aging Board, and many of them I've appointed and reappointed in many cases. So that's really all I can say about that. You know, in terms of how any multi-member board can operate. So, yeah.
I'm fine. Thank you.
Thank you.
Someone in the audience is asking to address a question, and I'll ask members of the committee if they would allow a question. It looks like there's a question from a member of the public here.
Sure.
And the question is to us,
yes.
Just so you know, not to the mayor.
Yes, I just want to make sure that I'm understanding this correctly. Is my understanding of the council that was put together hand-selected by, I'm understanding that the mayor hand-selected the council it just in order to advise him. And I just want to make sure that is correct, that the people that were selected to the council were all approved by him before this council was actually convened.
As the chair, I'll all of the members of boards and commissions are reviewed by the mayor's office, and the mayor sends appointees to the city council for confirmation. So any member of the Council on Aging, if it's during the tenure of this mayor, would have been appointed by this mayor. If it was during the tenure of the previous mayor, that person would have been appointed by that mayor. But it is a mayoral appointment to the Council on Aging, as to all boards and commissions in the city.
So this committee wasn't put together just to vote on or advise.
I'm sorry, do you mean the Council on Aging or do you mean the screening committee?
The screening committee.
Screening committee is also entirely at the prerogative of the mayor.
Okay.
The screening committee is not a mandatory feature. It's a best practice used by many in management.
Okay.
So
that's what I mean,
in this case here, the mayor put together a screening committee.
Okay, thank you.
Yes, one other question?
I'm Marlene. I was on the Council of Aging Board. I was actually going to be the next chairman. They had pretty much elected me to come in as the next chairman next month. I just want to make a correction that they did not poll the Council of Aging Board when the mayor says we had two representatives of the Council of Aging Board. They did not represent us. They never asked us. They never polled us. After the meeting, this last Thursday's meeting, when we had five members resign, it was because we did poll. We did take a vote, and it was unanimous to Heather. So that means that the two people who were on the search committee misrepresented the Council of Aging.
Thank you for that point of information. And may I return back to the mayor for other questions or comments on those names?
Not really. I think you've cleared up the question about the Council on Aging process versus the screening committee process. I don't really have anything more to add other than, again, going back to my comments about public bodies and posted agendas and the way that works. So.
May I then, just as a follow-up to the question posed by the member of the public, is it your understanding that your screening committee was made up of individuals? For example, the person who was the city council member on the screening committee did not poll members of the city council to represent the city council per
yeah.
se, or nor did
yeah,
those
yeah,
members
I,
who
I,
were on the Council on Aging, they weren't representing the council as a whole, but they were individuals who happened to serve on the Council on Aging?
That is correct. No, I wanted to, obviously I wanted the chair of the, I chose the chair, regardless of who that person was, because I thought that was appropriate. And in fact, the chair served on the prior committee. And I selected Kathy Service, who is also a Council on Aging board member and obviously a long-term, lifelong resident who has an expertise in social services and particularly been doing a lot of work on projects related to age-friendly and dementia-friendly communities, and actually has just had a major article published on the latter topic. And so I thought that Kathy would be a good citizen representative in any case, but the fact that she also was an active member and volunteer on the Council on Aging Board is why I selected that. Again, I do want to be clear, as you said, when I put together these screening committees, I'm trying to select people that bring certain subject area, expertise that represent important, constituencies to help advise me in what is my decision. And again, it's the same process I've used in the past. I believe the last time I asked the chair, and I think I asked Jerry Ann Butler, who was then on the Council on Aging, to be on the screening committee. But again, it was me calling up this individual resident and saying, I'm putting together this committee, and would you be willing to serve on it in your capacity as a obviously a resident, but also as a member of the Council on Aging. So. Yeah, I did not mean to give the impression that was the case any more than I said that I asked the council to take a vote. I actually asked Councilor Dwight to serve this time. He's not here, so I can say, because he's one of the seniors on the committee, happy birthday. He just turned, I think, 62 last week. And he also has a pretty deep family connection to these issues. His mom was a sort of an expert in the field of gerontology. Has done a lot of work in the field of aging, so he has a real personal connection to this issue, and has played out in a number of different arenas. So, and he's also an experienced member of the council and an at-large member of the council and former president. So that's why I asked him, for example.
Yes, I'd like to take that. We'll go around the table here, then, please, Council.
My understanding is that there were four candidates that the screening committee deemed qualified and passed on to you, but they didn't rank order them, is that right?
That's correct.
You just got four without any distinguishing
ranking. That's correct, and I did not ask them to do that. I did not. I really, their role was really to screen. And as I said, I thanked the members. I actually called each member, you know, individually after the process to thank them for their service and thank them for, you know, giving the time to help me in this project. And so that was it. There were no rankings or anything like that.
Okay.
Yep.
Yeah, so I really appreciate Councilor LaBarge's line of questioning around the COA board and their responsibilities. So I just want to add, so there's no language that had within the bylaws or whatever for the board, including them in the process of selecting the director.
That's correct.
And within that, has there been a past practice around including the wishes or the thoughts of the board in a hiring practice? In other words, has there been a practice where that was overlooked this time?
All I can tell you, Councilor, is I've done this twice now, mm-hmm. In my time as mayor, and I followed literally the exact same process. I asked the chair and one other member of the COA to be on the same screening committee. Very similar composition, two COA members, a city councilor, Councilor LaBarge, and then I believe it was we had the Council on Aging director from, I think, Camden, Massachusetts, who served as sort of the subject matter expert, and then Sue Stone from our HR department, who staffs these interview process, conducted literally everything the same exact way. Went through the advertising screening. Folks were recommended to me. I did the sort of one-on-one interviews, and then I made my appointment and submitted it to the council. Identical process in every way. So that's all I can say to you in terms of the process that I followed. And obviously, I'm not sure if you were on the council at that point, but in terms of that process, there was no concerns raised at the time or no issues about it. I mean, obviously there are people who had opinions about whether or not Ms. Desmond was the proper choice, and that's completely, that's completely within people's rights, and I totally understand that. I'm in the unenviable position. I actually happen to think it's a great position to be at mayor. I love being mayor, but one of my difficult tasks is making the ultimate selection and putting forward the name of someone to be a department head, which I take that responsibility very seriously.
Mayor, hearing what I just heard from the public, in regards to SafeServe, aren't three of these inmates SafeServe?
Yeah, there's definitely, this is a question that's come up about the, specifically about the Bistro program. And obviously the assistant director was certified ServeSafe, as were several of the participants from the Hampshire County House of Corrections. And, we have clarified with the, with our Board of Health, which has independent jurisdiction over this in terms of interpreting the state's health codes, and there's just the requirement of one person being SafeServe to be present for a program like that. And obviously the SafeServe, we have other city staff who are also SafeServe certified, and I believe that it would be not entirely possible for other staff to attain that over time.
So somebody who is not SafeServe, but we do have three inmates who are SafeServe, the Bistro could continue on.
The key is to have somebody, so according to what the Board of Health, the health director has told me, is that the key is at the meal site itself, having at least one person who is certified. That's the interpretation we've gotten from the Board of Health. Obviously we will, one of the features of having kitchen, the commercial kitchen there, it's advantageous to have staff that have that certification. So we've had, obviously in the past, people who during the course of their employment have worked to obtain that certification, and I have no doubt that could happen again. And we have other, obviously other employees in other departments that for various reasons who obtain that as well.
Thank you.
Yeah.
Any other questions from the committee on the, regarding the process?
Well, this is like a ServSafe, the certification, ServSafe has a bunch of certifications. Mm-hmm. Which one is it? In other words, there's like a food handler one.
Food protection.
Food protection, okay.
My chief of staff has done some research on this when I was away, so food protection, I believe, is the one. You clearly understand this one.
I understand some of them, but not that one. It's okay.
So would you...
Are there other questions of the mayor about the process before we move on to his introduction and his appointing? Any others? Then, Mayor?
Again, I'll be very brief because I want you to have an opportunity to speak with Ms. Westberg. It's my great pleasure and honor to present her name to the City Council. As I said, when I announced her appointment, she has an extensive 25-plus year background in social services, including 7 years in her current position as the director of the Town of Williamsburg Senior Center and Council on Aging. Very impressed with her work there and during her tenure, the work she has done, albeit on a smaller scale, a smaller community, to really expand programming, do significant outreach to seniors, form regional collaborations with other agencies and regional agencies, as well as working to secure grants for various programs. Prior to her work at the Williamsburg Senior Center, she was a business owner, creator of a business called Art Star Creative Arts Lounge, which did a lot of work similarly with social service organizations, and did offer private workshops, camps, et cetera, combining her backgrounds in social services and human health with her background in art. I think note in her resume she has a master's degree in art therapy. She also has done extensive work in the field of mental health as a counselor, a psychotherapist, and as I mentioned before, art therapist. I mentioned the checks that I did, an impressive record in our neighbor community of Williamsburg, and I think she really brings a diverse professional life and life background, as well as her experience and track record in the town of Williamsburg. And so, it's my pleasure to appoint this professional and thoughtful leader to be the next director of our senior services department. And it's my pleasure to introduce to you Ms. Marie Westberg.
Hello, thank you for having me. Thank you, Mayor. I'm very excited about this opportunity. As you heard, I've been the director of Williamsburg for 7 years, and I think everyone knows that a part-time job is never really a part-time job. I've put a lot into that, to my work there, and I feel like I have a lot of life experience that's really been very influential to my work in that position as well. Did care for my mother-in-law who had dementia in my own home for 2.5 years. That really helped to influence everything that I did in Williamsburg, and it gave me firsthand experience in terms of knowing what was really needed, what a caretaker needs support around. And so I think that the experience doing the administrative work, doing the frontline work at the senior center has really prepared me well. Also, I think that working in a small town, I think that the city councilor who was on the selection committee actually said that I probably experienced a lot more lack of resources that's prepared me well for having the opportunity to look at the challenges here in a different way that can be very beneficial. I'm very excited about being able to come to a larger community and do more and affect more people, to have more people to actually participate in programming. And I think that we're in a unique time where we really need to prepare for a major shift in our culture that is coming with the rise in the population. And so I think that my focus will really be to see what the needs are here and what the interest is, and not to come in and force my views on people. Because I think that in order to be an age-friendly community, we really have to listen to the people, and we have to look at all the ways that we can live up to that name, to be an age-friendly community. And I know it's one of the governor's goals is for Massachusetts to be on the map around being the most age-friendly state. So I've been working hard on these things in my own community. And I think that that Northampton is also working on these things, and I've been involved in a lot of the regional approaches to a lot of these projects. So there are a lot of public health initiatives that are really being focused on statewide, but also as a region. And so the work that I've been doing in Williamsburg directly ties into things that are being worked on here as well, and those same committees that I am part of, Healthy Hampshire, MCOA, there's a lot of overlapping projects and funding that's being funneled into the cities and towns to work on making communities as age-friendly as they can be. And that when we say age-friendly, I like to say older adult. I don't like to say senior. Because I think that older adult means a lot of different things. And so when we're thinking about making a community age friendly, it's really making it friendly for everybody. And so I'm excited about the piece of working on the ADA projects that go on in town, because I think that there are so many ways that these things overlap. Because a sidewalk should be accessible to everyone, whether they're a little kid, or they're an aging person, or they're in a wheelchair. So, and I think that it does take a lot of voices to make these kinds of things happen. And Northampton has more resources than Williamsburg, but I've actually been able to affect a lot of change in Williamsburg, despite the fact that there aren't resources. I've been leading a healthy aging task force and advocating for complete streets. Which is actually happening in Williamsburg, despite the fact that people don't want to shovel their sidewalks and that there isn't money to pay for those sidewalks to be put in. I think that I'm in a good position to move right into work here. I don't think it's going to take me long at all to get to know people. That's one of the best parts of my job, is I love the variety. I love being on the ground and talking to people and actually getting in there. And this morning I was making lunch for the seniors in Williamsburg. So I like to get in the mix and really be connected to the people that I'm trying to help. And it's a job I take very seriously and I find very fulfilling. And I think that I have learned so much in the 7 years in my part-time job there, that's really full-time, I have a lot of ideas and a lot of experience to bring to this job. And I didn't actually put my restaurant experience on my jobs, on my resume, but I have restaurant experience, I have business experience. So I feel like having done all the jobs of my staff and running things in Williamsburg, that I kind of can look at everything from each person's staff person's position, because I've done it myself. The work that I've been doing, that's the coalitions that really match up in terms of Williamsburg and Northampton, with Healthy Hampshire and PVPC and MCOA, like, I think that there are a lot of partners that are already in place that some of the committees that I'm on, I will just be changing the name of the town that I'm working for on that committee. I'm on the steering committee for the Healthy Hampshire Steering Committee and also the Food Access Committee. So I really think that people are people wherever you go, and it doesn't really matter how many people there are or the issues are the same. We're facing the same issues. It's just maybe on a smaller scale in Williamsburg, but the issues of being an older adult in this culture, in this time, and with the population growing is a real issue that the city is going to be having to face in many different ways. And so it's really, I feel like the job of the Senior Center is to reach out into the community, to make those connections, to not just serve people within its walls, but to make the whole community function better and to embrace all the needs. So I feel like I have a lot to offer, and I'm really excited to show everybody why the mayor chose me. Because I really think that I'm hoping that no one will be disappointed. And I have worked with Heather, and I really understand why people like her so much. And I'm really sorry that she's leaving, because I would have really liked having her as my assistant director. And there are a lot of really great staff there, and looking forward to know everyone.
Thank you. Why don't we go around the circle this way? I'll start with Councilor.
Thank you. Well, thank you, first of all, for all of your good work over the years and for your interest in bringing that background and expertise to Northampton. I'm particularly interested when you talk about the skills and background and ideas that you bring in what you've learned about cross-generational programming, reaching out not just to other older adults, but to other generations.
Mm-hmm.
I know you've done a lot of that in Williamsburg, but tell us a little about how you would see that applying to your work here.
So I think if there's interest, I think I was misquoted in the Gazette. I have no plans to turn the Senior Center into a community center. I was really speaking about what has happened in Williamsburg and how excited our people are about the intergenerational connections. And I think that our culture, we're all very disconnected, and people live far apart, and some people don't have grandparents locally, or they don't have grandchildren locally, and they're craving that connection. And you know, it's integral to who I am as an artist and as an art therapist, to bring people together. It's something I really enjoy. And when you meet the needs of all the different kinds of older adults that there are, you will see all these kinds of things happening. You won't just see people hanging out playing cards. You'll see that there are many, many layers to services and ways of embracing the community. So people want to get involved, but they don't always want to get involved in activities at a senior center. They want things that they relate to or that fit into their concept of what would enrich them. So exchanging letters with sixth graders is what we've been doing for 2 years, and that's evolved, and the seniors and the students exchange letters, and then there are two in-person events that happen at the school. And those relationships have, a lot of those relationships have continued beyond the year-long program, where seniors are sort of kind of becoming foster grandparents. So I think that there, when there's a real connection and a need where people feel like they want to extend their family in some way or find some sense of family, that it continues on. And so it's helped me to see that there are many different levels of need. So some people might want to do a 6-week project, and they need to know there's only going to be, you know, 2 2-hour commitments. And that meets the need of some people who maybe are really busy, but they want to do some kind of intergenerational project. Or there are people who would like to have an ongoing relationship. So, and I think there are levels in between there too, where people may say, I'll do it, you know, I'll exchange 6 letters and I'll go to 2 in-person events. And then I'll consider signing up again next year. But so it's evolved, and so we've started an after-school program as well, so that seniors can do sign up for a 6-week workshop with kids and learn alongside them, well, as a pair, really. So there were 9 pairs of learning ukulele together, playing chess, Dungeons and Dragons. So just offering different ways to get involved and in the community, in places where people already may be familiar, they may be going to because they have grandchildren already at the school. So the other thing I've done is for 6 years, we've been making a film every year. I guess it's 5 years because we've made 4 films now. And we hold conversations where we ask questions of anyone who's in the room to talk about how do you get to school or how did you get to school? And we've been filming the stories that come out during these conversations. So many of the people that we've filmed have passed. We had the oldest person in Williamsburg, Jean Hemingway, who was the first select woman, talk about how she got to school on a fish cart. While, you know, kids are talking about how they ride their bike to school, or so just the sharing of stories and preserving our sense of history. And I think that our culture is, you know, we're all online, we're all really busy, and we don't sit down and tell stories anymore, and we don't share those connections. And I think that people are longing for it, and so if you create something that can feed that need, people will come together. And but it's also videotaped, so it's preserved and can be viewed at the library. So it's an archival project. It's a history project to preserve the history of the town. And I think that then the older adults feel honored and they feel appreciated, and the kids feel seen and heard, and they have that kind of connection that they may be really longing for too.
Thank you. I would think Historic Northampton might be interested, maybe done something like that with the Historic Society in Williamsburg, but maybe not be very interested collaborating on projects like that. Thank you very much.
Mm-hmm. Councilor Nash.
Sure. Thank you for coming in to speak with us today. I first want to thank you for your kind words for Ms. K. Helene, who the affection for her is fierce and palpable, mm-hmm. and that it's in the room, and it represents a lot of really hard work on her part, and it is a loss that she's resigned. Thank you for recognizing that. What I want to ask you about is 2 themes. One is a theme and one is a organization. So the theme of aging in place, and also, are you familiar with Northampton Neighbors? And that because I get emails from them about every 5 days and asking me to do something, and that and they're highly organized, and that your thoughts on
I'm very familiar with the village model, I've been working on that myself in Williamsburg. Have met with Linda over the last year and a half, about collaborating and consulting basically about what's going on here. I feel like the community, it's impossible to age in place without your neighbors and your, you know, some support, because isolation is really detrimental. And being a caregiver is one of the hardest jobs I think there is. It's harder than raising a child, because you're actually with someone with dementia, especially, you're unlearning. You don't have something to look forward to as a child's learning and they're growing. With someone with dementia, you're basically watching someone lose capability. And so you're mourning in the process. And so being a caregiver is very difficult. And you don't have time to take care of yourself. So if someone is trying to age in place and they are very isolated, and they have a caregiver who maybe can't meet all their needs or is burned out, a lot of things can go wrong, and risk is high. Risk for depression, suicide goes up. So I really think that Northampton Neighbors is a wonderful thing that has been established, and I'm really excited to be part of that and to expand on whatever needs to be expanded on when needs are discovered that are still being that are unmet in the community. Because I think that when you actually get into people's homes who need help, that's when you find out what all the needs are. And I've been running a companion program in Williamsburg for 6 years, and that's exactly the kind of thing that I found, is that you can't wait for people to call you for help. You need to embrace them where they are and make those connections with familiar people. So my outreach approach is now being implemented regionally in the northern and southern hill towns, and it's a grassroots model which aims to match peers from the community with people that they already know who are isolated, maybe not driving any longer, and can't get their needs met. And what we find is that once you make those familiar connections, you're not actually able to make those connections without the familiar connection. And once you do make them, that the needs start to pour out and people start to say, you know, I love that you come to see me once a week and we go for a walk or that we go out to lunch, but could you do this too? And could you do this other thing? Or could you take me here? And so then my job, then I can actually really do my job and get people connected to all the things that they really need. Because then the questions start to come out, and it's because they're comfortable asking. And so the companion match is the conduit to actually providing the service, and it's a preventative measure. It's not a reactive measure. So I really think that the senior center can't just be a social club. It needs to be a proactive agency that expands into the community, and not in a passive way, but in a very aggressive way, by partnering with community members. And I really think that it's the only way to actually help people who are struggling with their own dignity.
Councilor LeBart?
Yes. Some of the questions have been answered, but I just want to go over mine. You had stated that the Gazette had made a mistake on a statement that you just corrected. My question to you is, a community center. That rumor has been going around for months and months and months. I don't know when it's gonna end, but my question is, when you talk about integrating with children and so forth, and doing different types of programs with children and seniors. Are you saying also that they can integrate and come into the senior center? And my reasons for asking that is, at one point, we, which you probably know, the rec department wanted to come in and just put in some portable sections because they did not have a place to stay. And many seniors were very concerned about children roaming all around the senior center. Mm-hmm. Can you explain about you wanting to work with youth? Also, if they are welcome into that senior center, how would you go about that?
Mm. Well, I would never presume that people would want that. I think that really that would only happen if that's what the seniors wanted. I think that the senior center needs to have programming outside its own space, because then the community that exists there gets what it needs, and then the community outside, the people who will never set foot in a senior center because even if they're 90, they don't think of themselves as a senior. Though there are people like that who just don't want to be associated with the name senior. And so if you provide programming off-site, you're reaching a whole different set of people, and maybe in an environment that they're more comfortable in, but that's also more conducive to the needs of the programming itself. So I've run many activities departments. I have a lot of experience sort of working with groups and defining a program that meets the needs. And so I would never say we're having a program and all these kids are going to be coming and, you know, just get out of their way. Or, you know, I mean, I think that it's really needs to be come from the people themselves and what their wishes and needs are. So I've done gardening programs with kids and seniors, and we're out in the garden. And if you don't want to be around the kids in the gardening program, you just don't come. But it's not going to be in your face. There are choices, and I think that what people need to recognize is that there are lots of different kinds of older adults who have different kinds of wishes. And so it's our job to serve the needs.
Were you at the last board meeting that they just had recently?
Yes.
Where we had a resignation of four members of that board. As a city council, I've never seen that happen. There was no director there at all, I would assume, correct?
Was there
a director? Who were you with?
Mayor?
Yeah, just, I don't want to, she's the appointee. I just want to be clear that there was a Council on Aging meeting, and the chair had invited Ms. Westbrook to come.
Okay. That's what I wanted.
And was on the agenda listed as new incoming director as a chance to just introduce her. But she was not there in any staff capacity or serving in any role. She was asked to come as a guest and to introduce herself. That's the role that she participated in. I don't know I believe there was staff there. I don't know.
Yeah, there was staff.
There was staff. My question is
staff.
That here we have, and I'm just saying, if you were a director, that, just using an example, there was no director, you were invited, okay? You saw with your eyes where you had board members who were not happy, and they resigned. How would you have handled that situation if you were the director then and you were there to prevent those board members from not resigning? How would you have handled that? Because I'm looking at some of these board members that have been there for a long period of time. They have helped make that senior center what it is. And we have lost really hard-working people. So my question is, how would you have handled that, or if you could have,
what would you have done?
Well, I'm not sure what any director could do if board members want to resign, because they're volunteers and it's their choice. It's unfortunate, especially if they've been very active and have brought a lot to that board. And what I did say when I was there was that I was very inspired by how passionate everyone was, because it's not, a board doesn't always function that way. Sometimes it's hard to get board members to be excited about, you know, and so I was impressed with the passion in the room. And, you know, I think it's the board's job is to advocate, to be the voice of the people. The director's job is to try to address the issues at hand that the community is voicing. I can't really speak to what I would do if it was my job to do something about it at that moment. But all I can do when a board member wants to leave is to acknowledge what they offered and contributed and thank them. I think when people want to leave, it's their choice. It's a gift. Board members are giving a gift of their time, and we need people to do that. But it's not always the right fit. So if you can't always make everyone happy either.
I thank you for that comment. Now, were you the ADA coordinator in Williamsburg?
There is no ADA coordinator in Williamsburg.
So then you have no projects at all.
No, I had lots of projects.
But you're not an ADA coordinator. And this position also is / ADA coordinator.
Yes, I'm aware of that.
Okay, my question now is, if not the ADA coordinator, what do you know about the ADA laws in the MA Disability Commission?
So in my role at the Senior Center, I have dealt with many ADA issues. I have not held that position because a little town usually doesn't have an ADA coordinator. But I have been leading a healthy aging task force, which came out of the healthy aging and community design study that we did in Williamsburg. And that committee was made up of older adults who participated in a walk audit of Williamsburg. So I've been very involved in helping people advocate for changes in Williamsburg and on a municipal level, but also on a larger scale, sort of looking at planning, city, town planning. Recently this summer did a tactical urbanism project with PVPC, where we did a mock presentation, demonstration of actual physical changes that could be done to the environment to make the town more accessible and age-friendly. So I think that I have a lot to offer, and I'm excited about that part of the job, and I have no fears about being able to learn everything I need to know. I'm actually speaking in Boston on Friday at the Walk and Bike Summit about how rural communities are struggle to affect change on that level. So around adopting a complete streets policy. So we have adopted a complete streets policy in Williamsburg, and it's partly because of the advocacy that's come out of the aging task force. So I'm very proud of that work, and it's dear to me because it's my town and I want to walk there too. So
I am very happy that we were to meet Heather, to work with Heather, and I know for a fact for 10 years of going to that senior center, donating, volunteering, even my husband going and donating, Heather has a personality that everybody respected her. She made a decision, and that was her choice. Just like you said, it's your choice. And I wish her the best of luck. And I want to thank you for being here and being able to ask some of these rough questions that we're asking you. I have one more for you. How many seniors frequently visit your senior center?
How many seniors do you think that have come there, you think?
You should know.
Is that what you're saying? Well, so I...
Say on a daily basis.
I would say probably close to 80 on a daily basis, but we are serving people out in the community in their homes as well. I've been operating the companion program, a medical rides program. We had a van for a while, and have recently started a carpooling program so that senior drivers are driving groups of people on outings and errands, so that we're basically creating a social network so that peers are calling seniors who are homebound and inviting them to go out to do things. And that partly is because we don't have the staffing to do all the dispatching. So I think that the grassroots approach and doing things with very little funding is kind of become my expertise. And I've been running a meal program there for 6 years. Actually, the first year I was there, I received $22,000 in grants from Highland Valley, and Heather was the grant administrator who oversaw my site. And so I've known her for a while, and you know, I've done a lot of things with very little money. So I feel like with more staff and very capable staff, I should not have any problems meeting the needs of the community and the senior center. And it's too bad that Heather won't be part of that.
One more question, and that's it for me. When you say that the senior center, yes, we know it has walls, and it's best to come out of those walls and go on the outside. Linda Desmond and I talked very closely, and even Pat Shaughnessy, of opening the doors to people of Casa Latina and so forth like that, who felt uncomfortable going to the senior center, and those doors were open to them, and they are coming there, which I find really great to me, of having a different diversity of coming into that senior center. And how do you feel about that?
I think that the senior center needs to be inclusive and it needs to embrace its community. So if it's not doing that, then it's only serving a certain group of people, and that's a failure in my book. So there is a real push to be not just be age friendly as a community, but to be a welcoming place for everyone. Mm-hmm. So, you know, I do think that you have to find creative ways to make people feel comfortable,
right.
Especially if you're coming into an environment that where they don't see familiar faces. And sometimes bridging those barriers outside of the building first is a good way to do that.
Mm-hmm. And like I said, Pat Shaughnessy, who was a director before, and you know Patty, she, her, and I, and Pat Keller worked together of opening those doors, and when Linda Desmond came in, boom, she really went after spreading it out, and it's very important to me that those doors are open for all kinds of diversity to be there.
Yeah, and especially as our community is going to become predominantly older adults, I think that we have to advocate for everyone to get their needs met through the agency, because that's the mission. But also, we need to help people advocate for themselves too in the community. And if a large portion of the voters are going to be older adults, they're going to have a big influence on what gets done in the city. And so involving everyone in those discussions is really important.
What changed your mind? You apparently were accepted as a director in Belchertown, and then you get a call from our mayor or whoever that you were accepted here to become director. What changed your mind on that?
Well, Northampton is more home to me. my husband grew up here half-time with his divorced parents, and we moved here to be near family. And when I first moved here, I lived in Northampton, and so I know a lot of people in town. I was the chair at the Northampton Parent Center my first year here, and I met a lot of people. I feel more connected to Northampton.
Thank you for letting me ask you these questions, because it's very valuable to me to hear what your thoughts are and in which way you're going to move in the direction you're going.
Thank you, Councilor. I'll come back around the table. Are there any other questions from councilors?
No.
Thank you, Ms. Whisper.
Thank you.
So, if we were to just go right on the agenda, we could take up that matter, which is the appointment of Marie Gressberg. And I'll ask if there is somebody with a motion to put on the floor for discussion.
For discussion, I will put on the floor a motion that we move Marie Westberg's nomination as Senior Services Director to the full council with a positive recommendation.
Is there a second?
I will second.
Okay, moved and seconded. Okay, further discussion on that matter?
Well, I just want to say a little bit about why I've made the motion. I think sometimes it's important to make a distinction between whether you're listening and whether you agree with everything you hear. And I'm sure it's the case of other counselors, have done a great deal of listening and reading of emails and letters and returning as many phone calls as possible. And I've been telling folks that I intended to stay uncommitted because I didn't have much information to go on. I hadn't met Marie Westberg, I hadn't heard directly from her, I hadn't heard a detailed description of the process leading up to her appointment. But having heard about the screening process and the personnel process overall, which I think is a totally by the book and a total best practices practice, and having heard Ms. Westberg address the questions and rather fully address her background and how she would see it apply here, I'm quite comfortable taking all that into consideration, including all of the listening from folks who would like to see it go another way. I'm quite comfortable with the mayor's recommendation and to support it.
Any other discussion?
Okay.
I've been thinking about this a lot, and that and like other counselors, I've been receiving a lot of communications, and it's clear that there are many people who feel very strongly about Ms. Kay Helene, and that it's laudable what she's done in this community, but the process of how we got here to today, today we're not here to vote for or approve of anybody than Ms. Westberg. That she is the candidate who's been presented to us. The process was by the book, It was, as somebody who's been around employment for my career, that I found all of the checks and balances that the city went through and that the mayor put in place were terrific. 30 applicants applied, that the screening committee was balanced and chaired by a professional from our HR department. That screening committee sent forward 4 candidates for the mayor to choose from, and he chose an excellent candidate by, you know, the presentation that we received here today. And so my job is, right now, I see it, is to approve the candidate that's before me, and that's why I'm going to vote for a positive recommendation.
Any other comments, Councilor? I'm one of the councilors that asked the mayor's office of the process on hiring for a senior service director, and I want to thank one very, very much for sending it, along with some other councilors who have requested that process. I have to say that the many emails and calls I got about Heather, I was voting for Heather. Heather had already handed in her resignation, and Councilor Nash was correct. We are interviewing Ms. Westbrook. I have to say that there has been so much of he said and she said, and it's not the right information that many people had gotten from other people. It's the process. None of us even know who the other 4 candidates that were sent to the mayor. None of us know that. None of us, as councilors. Nobody knows how the interviewing process went and how they did on their interviews. The mayor and Lynn apparently determined and made that determination that he was well qualified to be the director. So, yes, I am supporting with my other counselors because of that reason.
Thank you. And finally, I'll just offer some remarks too. It has been difficult for me to, I've gotten some emails and calls, not all one way, but right. The majority of those were asking me to vote down the mayor's appointment. And so in order to do that, I had to think, to vote down the mayor's appointment would require me to consider that either the process was unfair or that the candidate, the appointment, was unqualified, the appointee. And in addition to those requests that I've had from people were to say, vote down the mayor's appointment and instruct him to hire, and I'll say just because I was Ms. Kaling. And unfortunately, that is not something that is in the, not unfortunately, but it's by our charter. We have no appointing authority. That authority lies with the mayor. So even were this council to find that the process were unfair or that the appointee were unqualified, there's no mechanism for this council to instruct the mayor to send a specific name. For example, to send the name of the now resigned Heather Taylor. That being said, I really appreciated the mayor and Ms. Westberg giving us a very thorough presentation in addition to the supporting documents we received. Resume and descriptions, and I'm very comfortable in supporting a positive recommendation. So I guess what I'll do is I'll just ask for a voice vote that's amenable. Yes. All those in favor of sending a positive recommendation to the full city council of the appointment of Ms. Westberg, say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Any opposed? Any abstentions? Then that motion carries. And I want to thank everybody who came to hear this. If folks don't mind, we might just ask for just a 5-minute recess so that we can take up the other items.
I'm sorry, I just have one quick question. If the rumor of a community center has been around for months, I'd say that means we need one.
Thank you for your comment.
Thank you.
Hi, Barry, how are you?
I just want to remind everybody that we're still rolling with the...
Still on a different time.
Excellent.
Yeah.
Actually, when it's running, just one of the things we're working on for you and that we look forward to working with you. Just the circumstances that...
Oh, and I'm very for the growth generational thing.
Yeah, I think what it was, it wasn't that you misquoted her. I think you just, she talked about cross-generational programs.
Right, and I accurately quote the stuff you said in the meeting, is what's in this in the article.
So, well, what I said was that those were firms I was doing, and there was interest.
I think when they read it, they were, I think people interpreted that they didn't understand what cross-generational was.
So, yeah, I mean, if you say I spoke about doing one generation programming, it sounds like I'm saying I'm going to do it, I can't do it. In fact, what I meant was that I'm doing it in a series,
right,
and people love it, but that I would only be doing it in Southampton if people wanted to do it.
Right.
And so they took that line and they ran to it.
And
right.
Said, she's coming here, she's going to bring kids in this
right.
center.
Yeah, I can see how that people could disturb that.
Yeah.
You did talk about it, that was like that, that was an interest, yes, of course, that if you apply, that you only use this permission, but I mean, that's how I remember it.
Going, Ms. Powers.
How are you?
Good, good. I need the list of people who talk so I can actually
sure.
You know how that works.
I do.
Now, you originated this position, didn't you?
What position?
The position of the city council actually having an active clerk, correct?
No.
For some reason.
That was way before me. I think Lynn was actually the first one.
Really?
Lynn Simmons. Yeah.
Huh.
Okay.
Yeah.
I also get the thing of the folks who's who spoke who didn't sign up on the thing, just so they can get their names correct?
Those are the only ones I put in. I added the two other people.
Okay.
I added their names.
You added the two other folks. Okay.
Yep.
That's not always done, so that's why
that's
why I stopped talking.
Dave Corbett's down there, right?
Dave Corbett. That's it. I'm used to having to, if there's additional
people,
go
there. No,
thanks a lot. Thank you very much. Appreciate it, guys.
Am I done? Thank you.
All right.
Counselors?
That too.
I want us outside.
It's cold, isn't it? Okay.
I'll
say that we're now back in
session. Now is when I'm reading.
Now
that's Don't tease me. I'll see you guys soon.
And I'll ask if there's a motion to approve the minutes of March 5th.
So moved.
Moved and seconded. Any additions, corrections, or otherwise? All those in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Thank you. So really, that just leaves us the outstanding four appointments that, when I was out of town, I wasn't able to assign. And I know that Council LaBarge has indicated an interest in reviewing the appointment of Vanessa Hade to the Housing Authority. And then, in addition, we have three appointments to the Arts Council. John Thorpe, Eamon Edge, and Dara Herman Zierlund. So is there any preference?
I'd be pleased to speak with Dara.
Dara, okay. With who?
Dara.
Any preference, Councilor Nash, of the other two?
I'll go with Eamon Edge. It sounds like a very artistic name.
Okay, then that leaves that leaves for me the appointment of John. I'll call John Thorpe.
Okay.
And I know that we had. I think we've pretty much taken care of everything then on the agenda.
I do too.
And we will have a meeting on May 7th to take up just those four appointments.
Right.
I didn't see any others on the, we didn't have any on the April 19th meeting. We didn't have any additional appointments, so we really only have those appointments. If there's something else besides those four appointments, maybe a continued discussion of the appointment process. I know that Councilor Nash wanted to have a broader discussion in an email, I think he sent to us, talking about people wanting us to take a broader view, a long range view, et cetera.
Yeah,
I can pull up the email if you want.
Gosh.
That's if you like, or what we could do is just leave that, we could have that again on our agenda if there are other questions or concerns.
Yeah, let's have that next time.
Okay.
And
I then find the email and review what I said.
And basically what that, there were two, there was the charter, but there was also the process that this committee adopted 3 years ago at this point. And that was for boards and commissions. And it's pretty, basically it's what we do.
Mm-hmm.
How we divvy up the duty and report back and make our decisions. So we can talk about that on the 7th. Right? Okay. Is there a motion?
I really got to look at that email.
Yeah.
Yeah.
I move to adjourn.
Seconded.
Moved and seconded. All those in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Thank you.
You're welcome.